It's here with gambling that NFL leadership is trying to play like a champion instead of simply remembering their helmet. You can't do much with violence in the game, you say? Fine. But encouraging gambling, bathing the NFL in gambling advertising, building sports books inside stadiums, official fantasy partner of the NFL? Well, this is what Charlie Munger was talking about. This idiocy is easily avoided.
Put that coffee down.
Creators are leaders. Be careful what kind of leaders you're producing here.
Helen, we're both in sales. Let me tell you why I suck as a salesman.
They realized that to be in power, you didn't need guns or money or even numbers. You just needed the will to do what the other guy wouldn't.
I'm not leaving. The show goes on.
Well, hello there, friend. Welcome back to the Construction Leadership Podcast. I am your host, Bradley Hartman. This episode is brought to you by Paradigm Estimate, a technology-driven takeoff service that gives you the speed, accuracy, and consistency it takes to win more bids. Spend less time on tedious takeoffs and more time on what counts the most, growing your business. Check out Paradigm Estimate at myparadigm.com/Bradley. That's right, my own name right there at the end of the URL. That is myparadigm, myparadigm.com/Bradley. Now, over the last several months, we've been working with a few different clients, and we've been talking about a similar theme, which is, to what degree do you want to continue to be on offense, to be aggressive, to push and to grow, and where do you want to kind of let the market come to you, to be smart, to avoid doing stupid things? And these experiences and these conversations have led me to think a lot more about this episode, which is titled Risk and the Art of Avoiding Stupidity. The sign above the player's entrance to the field at Notre Dame reads, "Play like a champion today." I sometimes joke that the sign at Nebraska reads, "Remember your helmet." Charlie and I are remember your helmet kind of guys. We like to keep it simple. Warren Buffett, chairman and CEO of Berkshire Hathaway. People are trying to be smart. All I'm trying to do is not be idiotic, but it's harder than most people think. Charlie Munger, vice chairman, Berkshire Hathaway. There are lots of ways to succeed in life. Thousands of line items on the long list of things to do. But avoiding stupidity, navigating around the most obvious dumb stuff people often do, well, that's a much shorter list. The likely causes of failure follow the 80-20 principle. The vast majority of negative outcomes stem from a few common inputs. Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger, the greatest investing duo of all time, would identify chasing fads as one of those. They famously remained on the sidelines during the dot-com boom and crash. They've been vocal about comparing unregulated crypto markets to a Vegas casino. They are not trying to bat 1,000 in the financial market because they've been around long enough to know it's not possible. They're trying to avoid stupidity through patience and discipline, letting the market come to them. Berkshire Hathaway, as of this recording, is sitting on $147 billion, with a B, $147 billion in cash right now. Think about that for a minute. Now, can you imagine how much discipline you'd need to not deploy some of that $147 billion in cash? Then, think about how much that money can grow simply because of its size by just sitting there. Charlie Munger calls it sit on your ass investing. You're paying less to brokers, you're listening to less nonsense, and if it works, the tax system gives you an extra 1, 2, or 3 percentage points per annum. Berkshire Hathaway owns 65 distinct companies, thoughtfully analyzed and intentionally acquired, plus cash on hand that surpasses the national gross domestic product of Morocco, ready to invest when the time is right. Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger aren't trying to be brilliant, but there's a million ways they could try to be brilliant, but they don't have to be. They're trying not to be stupid. And they know there are a small handful of ways that they'd be likely to be stupid. Their job is to avoid these, to avoid the banana peels on the sidewalk. And we should do the same. Forget investing, though. Let's take marriage. Things you should do in marriage? Well, there's a million little things. My wife has a list. It's long. For example, number 107, always buy 2 gallons of milk for the boys when you go to the store. We can never have too much milk. Number 877, show some restraint and avoid commenting, positively or negatively, about the menu typeface selections during date night. Now, things to avoid? 3 big ones solve nearly 90% of issues in marriage. Number 1, infidelity. Number 2, financial disagreements. Number 3, drug or alcohol abuse. What about business then? Is there a short list of stupid things to avoid in business? Yep. Let's start with banking. If you're a bank, you know what the worst case is. Everybody does. You've seen It's a Wonderful Life, right?
I got $242 in here, and $242 isn't going to break anybody.
Okay, Tom. All right. Here you are. You sign this. You get your money in 60 days.
60 days?
Well, now, that's what you agreed to when you bought your shares.
Tom! Did you get your money?
No.
Well, I did. Old man Putter will pay 50 cents on the dollar for every share you got.
50 cents?
Yes, cash.
Well, what do you say?
Now, Tom, you have to stick to your original agreement. Now, give us 60 days on this.
Okay,
thing.
Randall.
Are you going to Putter's?
Better to get half than nothing.
In banking, the giant banana peel on the sidewalk is a bank run. All your customers demand their money at the same time. All right, then. How do you avoid that? 3 primary ways. Number 1, diversify your customer base. Number 2, don't borrow long and lend short. And number 3, always have a chief risk officer in place. So Silicon Valley Bank, which recently went bankrupt, how did they do on these top 3? Yep, 0 for 3. She gone. That's stupid. Little sidecar here. If you're looking for something to read, there's a book called When Genius Failed by Roger Lowenstein. And it's an absolutely stunning book about the especially ineptly named firm Long-Term Capital Management and another shortcut to stupidity and ruin, which is leverage. Debt limits options and piling on more and more risk through leverage, chasing ever-dwindling returns, is such a common path of wealth destruction, it deserves its own chapter in a stupidity avoidance book. Again, that is When Genius Failed by Roger Lowenstein. I would highly recommend it to a friend. But what about sports then? Say the NFL, the National Football League. What kind of stupidity should the NFL avoid? Well, a top 3 comes to mind. Number 1, avoid a game that leads to short-term player paralysis. Number 2, avoid a game that leads to long-term brain damage. Now, before we get to number 3, allow me a quick digression. Now, regarding number 1, 2 recent NFL preseason games were ended prematurely following frightening on-field injuries that resulted in player paralysis. This, after the nation held its breath last year during the regular season when Buffalo Bill DeMar Hamlin went into cardiac arrest during live TV. And regarding number 2, the NFL's decades-long history of concealing its knowledge of brain damage to avoid paying former players has been well documented. And yes, the NFL's current effort to quote-unquote build a better game through better mouthguards and clever neck devices is a marketing campaign disguised as a commitment to change the game. Now, don't get me wrong. I love football. As a former collegiate quarterback with a handful of concussions, let me say this. The stupidity in football is baked in. Football is violent. This is why we love it. But when it becomes routine to end games prematurely because of player paralysis, it's time to start rethinking about what stupidity can be avoided in the NFL. Meanwhile, the biggest threat to taking out football altogether is the advancing brain research being done on chronic traumatic encephalopathy, otherwise known as CTE. CTE is currently only detectable in the deceased, but when it can be detected in athletes in the coming years, from high school to the pros, that's when the NFL knockout punch becomes legitimate. When parents learn their kids have any type of brain damage from organized sports, the lawsuits, they begin to fly. All right, digression complete. Where were we? Right, avoid paralysis, avoid brain damage, and number three, avoid gambling at all costs. It's here, with gambling, that NFL leadership is trying to play like a champion instead of simply remembering their helmet. You can't do much with violence in the game, you say? Fine. But encouraging gambling, bathing the NFL in gambling advertising, building sports books inside stadiums, official fantasy partner of the NFL, well, this is what Charlie Munger was talking about. This idiocy is easily avoided, and for decades, the NFL had. In April of 1963, NFL Commissioner Pete Rozelle suspended two of the league's biggest stars, Green Bay Packer Paul Hornung and Detroit Lion Alex Karras, for one full season for wagering on football. Now, if those names lack significance or relevance today, let's just say it would be like the NFL suspending Aaron Rodgers and Aaron Donald for the entire 2023 season. Paul Hornung was the best offensive player in the game, and Alex Karras, later George Papadopoulos in the hit TV show of my youth, Webster, was the most dominant defensive player in the league. So why were Paul Hornung and Alex Karras suspended? Pete Rozelle explained, "This sport has grown so quickly and gained so much of the approval of the American public that the only way it can be hurt is through gambling." 50 years passed and the NFL remained committed to avoiding stupidity. During a 2012 deposition, a lawyer for the NFL threw a stiff arm to the very suggestion of sports gambling because it would, quote unquote, negatively impact our long-term relationships with our fans, negatively impact the perception of our sport across the country. The league had grown exponentially from 1963 to 2000. Then, from 2000 to 2012, the league doubled its revenue. Then revenue doubled again from 2012, when that gridiron councilman confirmed the league's intent to avoid stupidity, to 2021. So, why the change? Why run a reverse now? For the same stupid reasons you warned your kids about. All the cool kids are doing it. It's like free money. It's already happening everywhere. It's innovation. We gotta adapt with the times. Now, of course, this is not what was really said. In 2014, NBA, the National Basketball Association, Commissioner David Silver surprised the world by writing an op-ed in the New York Times about rethinking common sense about gambling, reimagining a world of stupidity avoidance in sports. Silver brushed aside the 2007 scandal involving NBA referee Tim Donaghy, and that time former Commissioner David Stern made Michael Jordan quit basketball for baseball given his gambling addiction. Yes, I know, this is deep into conspiracy theory, but do the research. Tell me what you see. David Silver was basically saying, nothing to be concerned about here, friends. Nothing to be concerned about at all. That was all pre-internet. Gambling without technology involves the mob. And that, well, that is obviously bad. But gambling with and through technology? Well, that's nothing but smart capitalism. In fact, legal gambling almost always minimizes illegal gambling. After all, the owners of FanDuel, they're not going to come to your house. They're not going to break your legs with a baseball bat when you run up a huge bill on them, will they? Speaking of Major League Baseball, exhibiting nothing short of pure stupidity, given the legendary 1919 Black Sox, who threw the World Series, and the league's stance on Pete Rose, quickly backed the idea. Then, my own team, the 2016 World Series champion Chicago Cubbies, the greatest baseball team of all time, what do? They decide they will build the DraftKings sportsbook and connect it to Wrigley Field. Connect it. It's connected to Wrigley Field. This is the same organization that refused to install lights on the stadium 54 years after other teams did. Now, We're comfortable building a sports book connected to the stadium. The players can walk literally from the dugout to DraftKings Sportsbook. Okay. All right. Fine. Let's do that. Let's see what happens. So the NFL watches the NBA and Major League Baseball flip-flop. So they do the same. Now, what do you think happens next? Confronted with gambling reminders during every game, constant ads on ESPN, on TV, radio, podcasts, website, and the app, and in the damn stadium, what are the chances young NFL players with a ton of money might succumb to the messaging constantly directed at people just like them, but not them specifically, that are lining the pockets of the people that employ them, the owners? Those chances are pretty darn high. Predictable stupidity is followed by false outrage. NFL players gambled, owners threw the non-sports book at them. Here's a recent list of players that slipped on this giant banana peel on the sidewalk. Josh Shaw, Arizona Cardinals. Calvin Ridley, Atlanta Falcons. Quintez Cephas, Detroit Lions. CJ Moore, Detroit Lions. Shaka Toney, Washington Commanders. Jameson Williams, Detroit Lions. Stanley Berryhill, Detroit Lions. Yes, Detroit Lions, you got a problem. You got to figure this out. Isaiah Rodgers, Indianapolis Colts. Rashad Berry, Indianapolis Colts. Demetrius Taylor, Indianapolis Colts. Yes, Indianapolis, figure it out. Nicolas Petit-Frere, is he French? What's happening there? Anyway, he plays for the Tennessee Titans. 8 of those 11 players effectively ended their football careers by gambling. Now the owners, what can you do? They just shake their heads and mock disbelief. We told the players, they say. I put it right in the employee handbook. Everybody reads that handbook. Players gambling, you know this. It's bad news. It could jeopardize this whole thing we got going here. If it appears the players might be doing anything but playing their darndest. Now, unlike the NBA, which only has 12 players on the team, and Major League Baseball, which has a 25-man roster, there is just shy of 1,700 NFL players. A few of them gambling is the most likely outcome. Of course, this is going to happen. It will continue to happen, and not just in the NFL. 15 student athletes at the University of Iowa and Iowa State University were recently busted for betting on games, including the starting quarterback for the Iowa State Cyclones. Now, yes, what the hell is happening in Iowa? That is a legitimate question. But if you think this is an Iowa situation, you're being naive. Just wait. It's a human nature thing. $115 million were spent on gambling ads in January of 2023. $85 million on TV, $27 million in digital, and $2 million in print. Two generations of the golden family of NFL quarterbacking, the Mannings, Archie, Peyton, Eli, even the non-famous brother Cooper, are joining Oscar winner Halle Berry on Caesar's Sportsbook commercials. Are you kidding me? All the cool kids are doing it. Who else is on gambling commercials? Oscar winner Jamie Foxx. Oscar winner Ben Affleck, Shaq, Allen Iverson, Usain Bolt, Cristiano Ronaldo, Gronk, Charles Barkley, Kevin Hart, Ewan McGregor. Wait, Ewan McGregor? The actor? No. Conor McGregor. I don't know. Maybe both of them. Who cares? Paul Pierce, JJ Redick, Drew Brees. Yes, even Drew Brees. And if you're Hunter Deckers, the former starting quarterback at Iowa State, who bet on his own games, you don't think that seeing one of the greatest quarterbacks of all time pitching online gambling doesn't at least help you justify what you're doing? Now, I don't blame Drew Brees, but he's sure as hell not helping people like Deckers avoid stupidity. And I don't blame the NFL for online gambling, but its existence doesn't mandate their involvement, let alone warrant their enthusiastic and non-stop reinforcement. If Berkshire Hathaway can sit on $147 billion in cash, roughly the total value of the NFL and its 32 franchises, and it can avoid stupidity, well, why can't the NFL do the same? All right, Hartman, where's the counterpoint? Where's the counterpoint narrative demonstrating how people avoid stupidity and achieve success? Well, my friend, that's a good question. And let's depart from sports for the moment. For someone who desires to be a movie star, what are the top few things to avoid to give yourself a chance? Number one, don't avoid to attempt it outside of Los Angeles. Number two, avoid drugs and alcohol. Number three, don't run out of money. This is what a young Chicagoan, a graduate of Ripon College in Wisconsin, did in 1964. After a summer with the Belfry Players Acting Company, and I think we all know that esteemed group of thespians, well, he moved to LA and began auditioning for voiceover work. Realizing success in this line of work, which he had not achieved, still wouldn't allow him the income to stick around, he began to study the craft of carpentry. That's right. In addition to studying the craft of acting, he picked up carpentry. With his wife's pregnancy with her second child, the actor slash carpenter later wrote, "Through carpentry, I fed my family and began to pick and choose from the roles offered. I could afford to hold out until something better came along." And something better? Well, it did. In 1973, nine years after moving to Los Angeles, he earned his first meaningful role in a hit movie titled American Graffiti. Maybe you've heard of it. More bit parts followed over the next 4 years until he read for the role of Han Solo. That's right. Harrison Ford cared for the craft of acting so much, he sacrificed 13 years of his life to carpentry to give himself the longest runway possible to allow his career to take off. Now, what about country music? What should an aspiring country star avoid? Well, it's essentially identical advice as acting, except it's not LA. Number one, don't attempt it outside of Nashville. Number two, avoid drugs and alcohol. And number three, don't run out of money. Maren Morris, the country singer, explains her path, much like Warren Buffett, Charlie Munger, and Harrison Ford, in her 2022 song, Circles Around This Town. That's it. That's the idea. You get your ass kicked, but you hang around long enough to catch a break. A couple hundred songs and finally one hits. And then another. You live to fight another day. You give yourself a chance. The first step to learning how to win is learning how not to beat yourself. Avoid stepping on the banana peels. Play like a champion today? Well, it may be motivating, but it's far too vague. Remember your helmet. Now that's specific and it's simple. But if you're thinking it might be too simple, I'll close this episode with what every Buffalo Bills fan was hoping I wouldn't do. But I have to. I'm sorry. It's January 26, 1992. It's Super Bowl 26, XXVI, if that's helpful for you who also, like the Romans, see numbers in letters. Anyway, it's the Bills versus the Redskins. The kickoff goes to the Redskins. The Bills defense forces a three and out. And then the first hint that this game would not go the Bills' way. Future Hall of Fame running back Thurman Thomas does not run out to the field to join his teammates in the huddle. He's sprinting around frantically. Where? The sideline. Want to know why? He could not find his helmet. There are lots of ways to succeed in life, and there are thousands of line items on the long list of things to do. But avoiding stupidity, navigating around the most obvious dumb stuff people often do, well, that's a much shorter list. The likely causes of failure follow the 80-20 principle. The vast majority of negative outcomes stem from a few common inputs. Focus on those first with discipline. You do not need to play like a champion to succeed. You just need to remember your helmet. All right, friends, thanks for listening. That's all I've got. This episode is brought to you by Paradigm Estimate, a technology-driven takeoff service that gives you the speed, accuracy, and consistency it takes to win more bids. Spend less time on tedious takeoffs and more time on what counts the most, growing your business. Check out Paradigm Estimate at myparadigm.com/Bradley. We will now close out like we always do with our leadership mantra. You, my friend, are owed nothing. Deliver value first. Make it a great week.